Good morning, good morning. I'm Erin Brinker.
And I'm Tobin Brinker.
And we are on The Brink, the morning show on KCAA, AM 1050, FM 106.5, and FM 102.3. So glad to have you with us this Friday morning, and it's going to be a hot weekend.
Heck yeah, and I'm looking forward to it. It's the last weekend before the last week of school for me. Woo! Let the parties begin.
Partay. Yeah.
Partay. Yes, yes. It's, the end of the school year is always a fun time for a teacher. You know, all the chaos and the excitement of the kids. And, well, let's be honest, it's hard to get much real teaching done. So we do the best we can. It's like wrangling cats.
And that's just getting the teachers to, you know, to come together and get the work done. Well, I mean, the testing's over. Your grades are basically done. I mean, it's...
Yeah, well, I think I told you that this is... Today, I've got everything turned in. I just have to sit and finish grading stuff. And then next week, I have to get it inputted so that it's, you know, ready for their report cards. But I'm pretty much done with the grading, and you know, and there's all kinds of activities for the kids. That's the other thing. Middle school, they just load up the end of the year with the activities. Today, a bunch of the eighth graders are going to Splash Kingdom for the eighth grade day.
How fun!
Yeah, and then Monday we have our video production class puts on a big video assembly with all the stuff that went on during the year. That's always a big deal. The kids love to see that, and then. Tuesday, we have our eighth graders. We take them down to the park. We have a day at the park with them. Wednesday and Thursday, which are our last two technical days, is when we have all of our teacher versus students athletic games going on. So we do basketball and soccer and football and volleyball. And, you know, we play them all. And it's a lot of fun. And a lot of kids get to participate.
Right
and,
on.
It's a lot of fun. But, you know, that's the end of the school year. It's exhausting.
Oh, yeah, my heart bleeds for you.
I have to rest up this weekend to get ready.
So we have to give an update. We played, of course, Soundgarden coming into the show today. Chris Cornell, they're now saying that he died by a suicide. He hanged himself. The tragedy marks a sort of bookend to the 1994 suicide of Kurt Cobain, you know, because both of them were grunge icons. You know, Cornell was the frontman for Soundgarden, which formed in 1984, and was the first of the Northwest's grunge bands to break into the mainstream in the early 1990s. In its 1991 release of Bad Motorfinger, introduced America to the grunge's punk meets metal formula, angst-ridden vocals, heavy guitars, long hair, and flannel. Cornell started out as a drummer and played some guitar, but his soaring four-octave voice was Soundgarden's key ingredient. And I would say that, because, you know, if you think back to the hair bands of the 80s,
yeah,
where the men all sang very high, and you had, okay, so I'm going to let out a secret. I'm not a fan of Vince Neil's voice, because I find it very thin and reedy, and very just shrill. And he, of course, is the front man for Motley Crue, which was insanely popular in the 80s. And then comes Chris Cornell with this richly, deeply masculine voice that was like a breath of fresh air.
Yeah.
You know, so it was, his voice is incredible. Like I said yesterday, if he were born at a different time, he probably would have been singing opera. He was a magnetic force in the early 1990s Seattle rock scene, organizing a tribute for his close friend and local singer named Andrew Wood, who had died of a heroin overdose. The project, Temple of the Dog, brought together members of Wood's band and a newcomer to the Seattle, Eddie Vedder, who soon after joined Pearl Jam. On Temple of the Dog's hit Hunger Strike, Cornell and Vedder sang a duet. And of course, Eddie Vedder had that same kind of masculine voice, you know. And I'm not calling Vince Neil and all the hair band guys feminine, but the voices were different.
Yeah.
They were higher. They were thinner. They were, you know, it was a different time. In the 80s, everybody wanted the big high voices for men.
Yes.
And the 90s, the grunge movement brought exactly the opposite. Because Soundgarden was at the forefront of the genre, the Sub Pop label was formed partially to produce the band's earliest music. Cornell was seen as one of the scene symbols and architects, said Mark Yarm, author of Everybody Loves Our Town, An Oral History of Grunge. Even back then, from what I gather, he was kind of larger than life, Yarm said. He tended to perform shirtless. He was sexy and brooding and mysterious. He was probably the guy all women wanted and the guy all guys wanted to be. And so, yep, it's what a loss.
So he was a married father of three, and he died in the middle of the Soundgarden tour. They found him unconscious in his room at the MGM Grand Casino by a family friend, And, of course, he was declared dead shortly thereafter, according to Detroit police. His wife and lawyer issued a statement pushing back on the notion that Cornell wanted to die. The lawyer, Kirk Pasich, said that the singer was a recovering addict and was taking an anti-anxiety medication that may have contributed to his death. The family believes that if Chris took his life, he did not know what he was doing and that drugs or other substances may have affected his actions, Pasich said, noting that his anti-anxiety medication, Ativan, can cause paranoid or suicidal thoughts. Cornell's heartbroken wife, Vicky, said, "Chris's death is a loss that escapes words and has created an emptiness in my heart that will never be filled." She said that Cornell spoke to her before the show and they discussed plans for a vacation over Memorial Day. But when they talked after the concert, she said, "I noticed he was slurring his words. He was different. When he told me that he may have taken an extra Ativan or two, I contacted security and asked that they check on him." Cornell had spoken in the past of suffering from depression and substance abuse, including a drinking problem that blossomed during his time with Soundgarden. He credited rehab for getting clean. So, I mean, this is really sad, and if, in fact, it was a side effect of the medication, I suspect we'll see lawsuits coming or at least some sort of investigation to find out just how much he had ingested, right?
And how do you prove that?
Yeah. Exactly.
I mean, obviously they're going to do a toxicology report, but you know, the more and more we learn about brain chemistry, this kind of the scarier it becomes, because you know, we have these heavy duty drugs that change your brain chemistry, and in some cases they're really needed and they're really beneficial, but for others they're not.
Yeah.
You know, and so, you know, do we need to have more testing? Do we need to, I don't know.
Well, and I think some people might be more sensitive to these things than others, you know, and I think that as we get a better understanding of genetic code and how all these things work, I think we're going to see medicines that are designed specifically for specific people as opposed to just a generic medicine that anyone can take. Because I think that there's been research that suggests that different types of people have very different levels of response to different types of medicines.
It's true.
You know?
It's true. So with that, we're going to take a break. I'm Erin Brinker.
And I'm Tobin Brinker.
And we are on The Brink, the morning show on KCAA AM 1050, FM 106.5 and FM 102.3. And we'll be right back. I've got another confession to make. I'm your fool. Everyone's got their chains to break. Holding you. Were you born to resist? Don't be abused. If someone did it the best, the best, the best, the best of you. If someone did it the best, the best, the best, the best of you.
Hi everybody, Ray Lucia here with some important information about debt, your debt. Whether you have a first or second mortgage, you're looking to buy or refi a home or rental property, or just need to consolidate your credit cards to lower your payments and save some serious interest, you need to do some loan financial planning with Steve Allidort, my mortgage man, at loanfinancialplanner.com. Now, Steve's not your garden variety mortgage broker. He actually spends time evaluating how you can use the current super competitive interest rates to pay off your mortgage early. Purchase a rental property, improve your cash flow, upgrade to your dream home, or even help your kids or grandkids get into a house. That's what loan financial planning is all about. Steve's been helping me and my listeners for over two decades, and I can tell you he is the best finance guy in the business. Go to loanfinancialplanner.com. That's loanfinancialplanner.com. Or call Steve Allidort at 888-563-1070. That's 888-563-1070.
Hi, folks. Let's wind the clocks back 60 years. Food was different. Food provided health and nutrition, and using supplements was minimal. Unfortunately, now we have chemicals, GMOs, herbicides, and pesticides that can be quite lethal in the name of our food supply and, of course, the ever-loving dollar. Supplementing our diets can be very important to stay healthy. Cleansing from daily intruders to the body might be critical. Live strong and take charge. Log on to GetTheTea.com. Our herbal tea is a great way to cleanse from intruders. Our supplements is a great way to maintain and improve your health. When your health is not up to par, go to GetTheTea.com. No GMOs, no fillers, and organic. And very helpful in keeping you at the top of your game. Life is too short to feel, you know what I mean. Stay in the game, at the top of your game, with GetTheTea.com. That's GetTheTea.com. Again, GetTheTea.com.
So, you love talk radio, then you'll love TalkStreamLive.com. TalkStream Live is always on, 24-7, with the best streaming talk shows. Find your favorite talkers and discover some new ones. It's free, readily available online or on mobile with any smartphone or tablet. Finding your favorite talk shows all in one place has gotten a whole lot easier. Just go to TalkStreamLive.com. Be sure to download the free apps from Google Play or the iTunes App Store.
For several years, KCAA has been marketing the Youngevity brand of nutritional and personal care products. Our experience with Youngevity has been 100% positive, so we are pleased to recommend them to you. Regarding nutritional supplements, we recommend Pollen Burst in the berry flavor and Tangy Tangerine 2.0 in the tablet form. For regularity issues, we recommend 3-Day Cleanse, and for personal care, we recommend Morning Hydration Cream. You can shop online for Youngevity at www.kcaateam.com, or you can order by phone by calling 800-982-3197 and tell customer support that you are part of the KCAA team. Youngevity is an American company based in San Diego. Call Youngevity at 800-982-3197 and ask about monthly auto ship that allows you to buy Youngevity products at wholesale prices. That number again, 800-982-3197.
We can't be everything to everyone, or can we? The station that leaves no listener behind, KCAA.
Welcome back. I'm Erin Brinker.
And I'm Tobin Brinker.
And we are on The Brink, the morning show on KCAA, AM 1050, FM 106.5, and FM 102.3. Little flyleaf there. Love that song. So the big, big news of the week, since the inauguration, seems to be Trump and the Russians.
Russians? Oh, no.
Really? That's all you've got?
Well, I'm at a loss because I didn't see an article that we had posted about Trump and the Russians, so I'm looking for the article. I'm going to get it. I'm going to find it, Erin.
This is how we prep for the show because we're super professional.
I'm still not seeing it.
Well, okay, but do you, like, listen to the news?
I do. I listen to the news, but, you know, this is the Friday before the last week of school.
Uh-huh. Yeah, okay. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So, Well, there's a special prosecutor has been named to look into this, and I honestly hope that the whole Trump Russia leaks, Comey firing, all of that, it's quiet for a while. We just let the special prosecutor do what he does. Yeah. Mueller is his name, and do his thing, and he will be thorough and he will be quiet about it. From what I understand, he's not a leaker. He's not a media hound. He's not like Comey is.
No, and he actually has a reputation that is impeccable. He's the only he's a former FBI director. He's the only one who ever served more than 10 years who was the guy who founded it? Hoover, J. Edgar Hoover.
Yes.
Yeah, he's the second longest serving, appointed by two different presidents. They actually had to change the law to allow him to continue to serve in the Obama administration because Obama wanted to keep him on for a little bit longer. He's got an impeccable reputation. And after he left the FBI as director of the FBI, he has been doing investigations privately. And he was brought into several very high-profile ones. Probably the most high-profile was the NFL when they were doing their Ray Rice investigation about him beating his wife and whatever. And he did an investigation and turned in hundreds of pages that was so thorough. You know, I mean, really got into all the nitty-gritty details of how the
Which
NFL...
Which is what you should be doing.
Yeah, of how the NFL operates and was there, you know, was there a cover-up? Was there some special favoritism? Was there, you know, and they had a variety of questions they wanted him to look at, and he answered all of them in great detail. And so, you know, he's the kind of guy that you want doing this sort of operation, and he has people around him that have worked with him for years that will help him to do this, and he knows how to get this kind of job done. So, yeah, they got the right guy. They got the right guy.
So now we need to let him do what he does.
Yeah.
Now we need to leave him alone. And it may be a year before we hear a peep out of him.
Yeah.
But, you know, he's respected on both sides. You know, give him the chance to do what he's going to do. And everybody needs to shut up about it.
Yeah. And by everybody, that includes
President Trump.
President Trump, who loves to tweet about this kind of stuff.
God, somebody take away his phone in the middle of the night. Right. I'm serious. Or the wee hours of the morning. Because he made an official statement, which was a good official statement yesterday, a very bland, you know, we're getting to the bottom of this kind of statement. And then he starts tweeting first thing. I mean, day before yesterday.
Yeah.
Then he starts tweeting and he blows up any good that any presidential sound or presidential, making himself look presidential gets blown out of the water.
Yeah. Now, you know, his verbiage about it being a witch hunt and he's being the most what was the word they used? Not oppressed, but that he's being
persecuted. It took me a second. I got to remember that word.
Yeah. He just ridiculousness of Trump, right?
Yes.
The hyperbole of it all. And people are like, you know, no, other presidents have had it much worse.
Well, yeah. I mean, even Ken Starr crawling through the Clintons business for, you know, a better part of a decade.
Yeah.
You know, was I'm sure that they felt pretty persecuted through all of that.
Yeah.
Now, it took them, you know, the thing about a special prosecutor, though, Ken Starr kept digging until he found something.
Yes.
And so this is how it works. They're going to find something. Oh, they're going to keep digging.
Well, and this is, I think, why a lot of leaders in politics now are really hesitant to begin this sort of special prosecutor type of investigation, because they tend to grow legs. You know, you start off on one topic, and before you know it,
you start out in Whitewater, and then you're in Monica Lewinsky land.
Exactly. And so, you know, you really want to be very careful about the mandate you give them, and that they are sort of very limited in scope. And I don't know that we've been able to do that yet. I mean, it seems like, you know, what happens is they get started, and then there's some revelation that leads them to some new thing, and before you know it, they're on this entirely different tangent that never was expected. And they just, like you said, just keep going.
They're pulling the strings on the sweater.
Yes.
And that sweater's going to unravel.
Yes.
And you're going to have somebody standing there naked.
Yes.
Just saying. So we'll see what happens. Now, something that's really interesting, the FBI frontrunner, it looks like, is Joe Lieberman.
Yeah. Now, I thought that was fascinating. You know, and it seemed like some of the names that were being floated were particularly Democratic names that they thought that the Dems would support. But Lieberman has no love in the Senate. The Democratic Party views him as a turncoat.
Because he left the Democrat Party.
Yeah.
Well, and I don't really blame him having left, because
he was forced out.
Yeah.
Because he wouldn't toe the line on the liberal orthodoxy on the military. You know, he was a Cold War Democrat, and he believed that we needed a strong military. And the Democratic Party was not going that way. They'd become the anti-war party. And he didn't fit.
It seems like an odd choice, because he was never a U.S. attorney. He has no federal law enforcement background.
Yeah.
He'd been in the Senate since the dawn of time, hasn't he?
Yeah, he'd been there for a long time. You know, I think too, though, it's about getting the votes. It's about someone sort of saying, who can we get through relatively easily? He's liked by Republicans. They thought he was liked by Democrats, but obviously Democrats are pushing back. And he's a guy who's generally respected as having character, you know, someone who stands up for what he believes. you know.
It's also, wouldn't you want somebody who wasn't, I mean, by nature of having been in the Senate, he's a political person.
Yes.
Don't you want somebody who seems, at least has the patina of being non-political in that position?
Yeah, you would think so, right? I think that they're looking, you know, they should be looking to sort of restore the reputation of the FBI. And a lot of people, I think, are concerned, you know, that the FBI is no longer seen as being legitimate, that they've been too politicized. And again, Lieberman is somebody who came out and supported John McCain, you know, the Republican candidate when he ran against Barack Obama. And I think that this, you know, gives him a sense of this is a guy who's bipartisan, who believes in doing the right thing regardless. You know, and I think they thought maybe he might help to clean things up. I don't know. And apparently he had a good meeting with Trump. Trump liked him. You know?
Okay. Well, I like Lieberman. I mean, you know, I think that he's, whether you agree with him or not, he's a man of character. He'll stand up for his convictions.
So you and I are unusual people in that back when John McCain was running for president in 2008, before he picked Sarah Palin, we both had thought that it might be a good idea for him to pick Lieberman because of what the country was going through at that time, that it would have been nice to have a true bipartisan presidency. You know, we haven't seen that in forever, where you would have a president from one party and a vice president from another. But there were people within the Republican Party that said if McCain had done that, he would have just lost all of his Republican support. You know.
So it'll be interesting to watch. I don't know that he's a good choice. I understand what they were going for, but I think that they'd be better picking a very qualified but otherwise anonymous U.S. attorney for that position.
Yeah, I agree.
Somebody who understands the inner workings of federal law enforcement. So with that, it's time for a break. When we get back, we'll be talking with Joanne Yanez. Can't wait for that. I'm Aaron Brinker.
And I'm Tobin Brinker.
And we are on The Brink, the morning show on KCAA, AM 1050, FM 106.5, and FM 102.3. We'll be right back.
KCAA Loma Linda, 1050 AM, K292 FQ Riverside, and K293 CF Moreno Valley.
NBC News Radio, I'm Bill Trefiro. President Trump is about to start his first overseas trip since he entered the White House. When he leaves today, his first stop will be Saudi Arabia, followed by Israel, and then Rome, where he'll meet with Pope Francis. Trump will then go to Brussels for a summit of NATO leaders and wrap things up with a G7 economic summit in Sicily. We're learning more about the Michigan woman killed in yesterday's Times Square rampage. Alyssa Elsman was just 18 years old. She graduated from high school last year, and her principal, Eric Albertus, says he's stunned by her death.
Alyssa was a really thoughtful, really bright, very pleasant young lady. I'm, to be honest with you, kind of struggling, to be honest with you, about the whole loss.
Alyssa died at the scene when a wrong-way driver mowed down a group of pedestrians on the sidewalk. Her 13-year-old sister was also hit, along with their mother, and both are hospitalized. An Amtrak engineer is out on bond after being arraigned in Philadelphia yesterday on charges related to a deadly crash. Scott Pringle has that story.
Charges against engineer Brandon Bostian include involuntary manslaughter and causing a catastrophe. The complaint states Bostian knew the route well. He was in control of the Amtrak train that accelerated to more than double the speed limit as it approached a curve in Philadelphia. The train derailed, killing 8 people and injuring more than 150 in May of 2015. An NTSB investigation shows Bostian lost situational awareness.
People whose computers were hit by the WannaCry ransomware attack are running out of time to pay that $300 in Bitcoin the hackers are demanding to restore their data. And now the New York Times is reporting that most victims are taking a pass. Early estimates were that the hackers could collect ransoms in the hundreds of millions of dollars. But so far, only about $90,000 has been paid. Folks have been gathering in New Orleans at Lee's Circle to await the removal of a fourth and final Confederate monument. A 130-year-old statue of General Robert E. Lee is being taken down today. You're listening to the latest from NBC News Radio.
It's time for your KCAA AM 1050 FM 106.5 and FM 102.3 traffic report. I'm Erin Brinker. In Riverside on the 15th southbound on the 79 Winchester Road, or between the 79 Winchester Road and the 79 South Temecula Parkway. I said this in Riverside. It's Riverside County and Temecula. There's some stop-and-go traffic. In the city of Riverside on the 215 southbound after La Cadena Drive slash Center Street, an accident has been cleared, and there's some stop-and-go traffic from La Cadena Drive slash Iowa Avenue. This has been your KCAA traffic. We are the stations that leave no listener behind. I'm Erin Brinker.
From the KCAA Weather Center, I'm Joel Hillsman. For this morning, sunny with a high near 87, calm wind out of the west at 5 miles per hour during the afternoon hours. Tonight, clear with a low around 58, west wind at 5 to 10 miles per hour out of the southeast with gusts as high as 20 miles per hour. Into Saturday, sunny with a high near 92. Saturday night, clear with a low around 63. Today, sunny with a high near 87. Tonight, clear with a low around 58. That's your weather forecast for this hour from KCAA 1050 AM, 106.5 FM, and now 102.3 FM, 3-in-1, the trifecta of talk in Southern California.
Are you still trying to spray away your embarrassing bathroom odors? Now you can vent them away through your toilet as they occur with the MG Toilet Odor Venting System by Manderly Gate. There are no filters, sprays, or batteries to ever buy or replace. Let MG equip your toilet and never worry about embarrassing bathroom odors again. Go to mgequip.com or call 1-800-542-9616. Again, mgequipped.com or call 1-800-542-9616.
Manderly Gate.
mgequipped.com or call 1-800-542-9616.
What a great gift idea.
Inland Body and Paint is a family-owned and operated fleet collision and repair shop that's proud to live in and help our community. Bring your heavy-duty trucks and or equipment to their fleet collision and paint center in Fontana for expert collision repair services. With 35 years of experience, you're sure to receive quality workmanship at an excellent price from Inland Body and Paint Center. From fiberglass repairs to quality painting, they'll take care of your truck and equipment from top to bottom in their new 64-foot spray booth. By the way, Inland Body and Paint of Fontana repaired and repainted the KCAA truck, and they can do the same job for your car, truck, or heavy-duty equipment. Inland Body and Paint, dedicated to the community and to your satisfaction. Call them today to learn what they can do for you. You can find Inland Body and Paint on Valencia in Fontana. Call them at 909-434-0466 or online at inlandbodyandpaint.com.
KCAA.
Get up, stand up. Stand up for your right. Get up, stand up. Stand up for your right. Get up, stand up. Stand up for your right.
Welcome back. I'm Erin Brinker.
And I'm Tobin Brinker.
And we are on The Brink, the morning show on KCAA, AM 1050, FM 106.5, and FM 102.3. We welcome back to the show Dr. Joanne Yanez. She is the Executive Director for the Association of Accredited Naturopathic Medical Colleges. She's a regular guest on our show talking about both naturopathic medicine and human rights issues because you know, what you experience in your life so impacts your health and vice versa. And so, Dr. Yanez, welcome back to the show.
Good morning. Good morning. How are you both?
Doing great. Tobin's great. He's wearing a Hawaiian shirt, looking forward to the weekend.
I'm ready. Bring it on.
So there was a study that came out, I think it was last week, talking about health disparities based on your zip code, and the differences were incredible.
They really were striking. It was one of those things that you kind of know maybe in the back of your mind, but seeing it on paper made my mouth drop. And so really the article discussed a 20-year disparity in life expectancy based on where you live.
That's
and that
insane.
Is in the United States of America. In the United States of America. And so places like Rosebud, South Dakota versus ski resorts in Colorado, you've got a 20-year gap in the life expectancy of a human in the United States of America. And, you know, it's really interesting, guys. I had actually lived out in South Dakota for 4 years and had the opportunity to go out to the reservations, a number of reservations in South Dakota, and see things firsthand. And, you know, I'll never forget, and I wasn't a mom then, but I am now, 9 o'clock at night, I was at my friend's home on the reservation, and there were a couple kids, there was a group of kids, they couldn't have been more than 7, 8 years old, tops, walking around by themselves, dirty and shoeless, asking for food.
Oh, my God.
Because they had not yet eaten. And my heart just went out. I said to my friend, I'm like, how can you not just open up your kitchen every single night? Because, you know, I would not be able to turn hungry kids away.
Oh, my gosh.
And so, you know, and I saw that firsthand. But how many folks really get to see that, really get to understand, you know, what we're seeing in some places that, you know, here in the United States. And so, you know, I remember years ago when I was in school reading about Healthy People 2020. And the whole premise of this program from the government, from our government, was really equity, that every single person is valued, that there's fairness in healthcare. And so, you know, when you're thinking about health disparities, really what you're talking about is it's so multifactorial. There's so many different issues, from socioeconomic issues to how providers interact with people from different backgrounds, and everything in between that impacts the healthcare that people receive. And, you know, there are education issues. There are lifestyle and, you know, economic factors as well. But there are some that are in our control. And, you know, those are the ones that I always like to think about first. You know, what is it that we can do? What are we able to make a change in? And, you know, when we see these health disparities and the disparities in life expectancy, you know, so much of it boils down, about 60% of it-ish is socioeconomic, but that still leaves 40% that we have that is not, that, you know, those of us in healthcare can make an impact on. Sedentary lifestyles, smoking, alcohol, mental health, those are all areas that we can do something about.
Now, you know, I imagine if you're living in an area where there are kids going hungry, I imagine that there's a feeling of despair among people who live in that area, you know, as you see in a lot of low-income communities. And you don't even have to go as far as the Dakotas. You know, the difference between Loma Linda, and we've talked about this on the show, the difference between Loma Linda and neighboring San Bernardino as far as life expectancy and quality of life, et cetera, is tremendous. You know, Loma Linda being the only blue zone in North America, I mean, that's where they have a large number of people who live past, I think, 85, or maybe make it to 100, and then San Bernardino, where life expectancy is much lower. You know, I wonder that mind-body connection has to play a huge role.
You know, there's mind-body, but I think, you know, honestly, there is so much more going on. There is, you know, there are just general socioeconomic factors. So if you think of what is a health disparity? Health disparity means that two people go and have totally different health expectancies based on nothing more than a factor that's not in their control. Their gender, their ethnicity, their zip code, like you said. And so, you know, when we think about health disparity, something like just being born as a black infant, you have a higher mortality rate than a white infant. Maternal mortality, again, higher with black women. You know, those are the types of things that we're talking about. And so, yes, there is a blue zone, but, you know, how many of those factors have to do with just some general disparities that exist in this country? You know, with elderly adults and disability rates, we see much more inversely related to income. You know, there's so much literature around this. Even with obesity, obesity is more prevalent in adults with sensory, physical, mental health conditions. You know, where do we draw the line? Where do we start to say, you know what, all people deserve a chance, regardless of what's going on. And that's where I come from. You know, when I saw those kids, it was like, wow, you know, they are already starting behind. They're starting the race 10 paces behind the line. And, you know, how do we equal the playing field so that everybody has a fair shot?
So from a policy standpoint, because that's really what we're talking about, we're moving into the area of policy, you know, how do you approach this? Because it's such a complex question, even for a small area, but for the United States, with all of its diversity, geographic and demographic, you know, how do you start? Where do you start?
Personally, I think you start with children. You know, when if you have healthy kids who understand and learn and have a good shot at life, they're going to hopefully have a better chance of being healthy adults. You take away the things that will give them less of a shot at being at having a good chance at life. You make sure that they are educated. You make sure that they've gotten good nutrition. You make sure that they know about healthy communication, that the folks who are interacting with those children also know how to take care of them appropriately. You know, and that to me has always been the starting point. If you start with the kids, you make sure that they've got a fighting chance.
So how do people get more information about you and about the AANMC and, you know, kind of get mobilized about issues of health?
Sure. Well, the AANMC is online, AANMC.org. And, you know, as a naturopathic doctor, I'm so personally passionate about this because we deal with all of the chronic issues that affect Americans on a daily basis. And, you know, as a doctor, if we can't deal with the basics for health from a policy perspective and from an individual doctor perspective, we're missing the battle. So for AANMC, you can get a hold of me there. We're also on Facebook and LinkedIn and Twitter and Instagram and you name it, you can find us. So A Apple, and Nancy, and Mary C. Charlie.org.
Oh, you said that so well. It stands for the Association of Accredited Naturopathic Medical Colleges, AANMC.org. So, Dr. Joanne Yanez, thank you so much. It's always a treat to have you on the air.
Thanks so much, folks. Have a great Friday. Have a good weekend.
Thank you. You too. All right.
Mm-hmm.
So, bye-bye. It's time for a break. I'm Erin Brinker.
And I'm Tobin Brinker.
And we are on The Brink, the morning show on KCAA. We'll be right back.
Exposure for your business or organization, check out Digital Network Advertising. Digital Network Advertising is where businesses display your ad inside their building. You can choose your marketing sites or jump on the DNA system and advertise with all participants. Your slide holds the virtual billboard for 14 seconds and is displayed 3 times an hour. It's a novel way to be seen, be discovered, and to be remembered. Digital Network Advertising with networks in Redlands and Yucaipa. Call 909-222-9293 for introductory pricing. That's 909-222-9293.
Get your earplugs ready for the next rave at the Orange Show. Find out when in the calendar section of the Grand Terrace City News. You can also catch local education, business, and sports and entertainment news in print and online at grandterracecitynews.com. The Grand Terrace City News, local news you use.
I'm getting older and noticing that my body just doesn't work as well as it used to. So I like to keep fit as possible by hitting the gym a few times a week. Recently, I started having a nagging bicep pain, and it got so bad I couldn't even lift the weights. When I was complaining about it to a friend, he told me about Angioprim. He said chelation helps remove toxins, heavy metals, and cholesterol in veins and arteries that may cause blockages. You know, after just 1 week of taking Angioprim, the pain was gone, and now I'm back in the gym full strength. Scientific research proves the active ingredient in Angioprim has superior oral chelation action that helps promote cardiovascular health. So to learn more, go to angioprim.com. That's A-N-G-I-O-P-R-I-M.com. Or talk to a trained consultant. Call Angioprim toll-free at 877-882-7221. You'll feel better with more energy. Call 877-882-7221 or go to the website angioprim.com.
This is Pastor Greg from Chosen Generation Radio Show, heard right here on KCAA, 1 p.m. Tuesdays and Thursdays. Do any of these sound familiar? Not sleeping well? Waking up tired? Drinking more coffee than usual? Can't stay focused? Craving sugary drinks and snacks? Feel like you're stuck on a treadmill? Having trouble managing your weight? Not sick, but not firing on all cylinders? Any one of these could mean that you might have a system overload, and Thyroadrenal might just be right for you. Think about it. You've probably been feeling like this for a while. Life has a way of wearing you down, and if you aren't getting the right nutrients, then physical and emotional wear and tear will take its toll. Most of us at some time or another could use some nutritional support for our adrenal and thyroid glands to bring things back in balance. Our bodies respond well to optimal nutrition to keep daily energy levels up and stress levels down. Try Thyroadrenal from Michael's Naturopathic Programs, a nourishing support formula with vitamins, minerals, and herbs to put back what life takes out. Look for Michael's on the label. We're serious about good health. Thyroadrenal is available at leading health food stores nationwide. If you don't see it on the shelf, then ask for it by name. Thyroadrenal.
Did you know that 80 to 85% of children's brains are developed by the time they are 3 years old? The San Bernardino City Unified School District is sponsoring free parenting education classes for families of children ages 0 to 36 months. Classes include free childcare, a light meal, children's books to take home, and weekly giveaways. Graduates earn a certificate of completion. For more information, please visit www.infanttoddlersuccess.org or call 909-347-7313.
You're listening to KCAA, your good neighbor along the way.
Man was bothering me today, and I wanted to tell him to go away, but I stood and listened to him anyway. Said he didn't want to shoot that man, and it was his thing, and I wouldn't understand, and he had done all that he can, okay? Okay.
Welcome back. I'm Erin Brinker.
And I'm Tobin Brinker.
And we are on The Brink, the morning show on KCAA, AM 1050, FM 106.5, and FM 102.3. So, there was a beauty pageant scandal.
There was.
Yes, there was.
There was, and this is the woman who won the Miss USA pageant.
Yes,
and
she was from Washington D.C. Beautiful woman. Her name is Kara McCullough.
Yes,
McCullough. How very Scottish of her. It's clarifying her controversial remarks on Sunday night's pageant when she called health care a privilege. Okay, so here's the thing: the thought police has infiltrated every part of American life.
Yes.
Really, who cares what Miss USA thinks about healthcare?
Yes.
Is she going to affect policy anywhere?
Well, you know, it's funny because these pageants, you know, one of the it used to be that the swimsuit section was like the one that everyone wanted to watch, right? See all these beautiful women in swimsuits. But now it's actually the question and answer part, because quite often they get asked, you know, these big sort of weighty questions, and they give like really bizarre or funny answers. And that becomes the story, right? And I don't think her answer was bizarre or funny at all. I think she gave a serious answer to a serious question. But like you said, the thought police, the politically correct society, can't have someone say what she said, right?
Right. Because so this is what she said, to be exact. I am privileged to have health care, and I do believe that it should be a right. McCullough. Oh, no, this was her statement. Before she said, I believe that it's a – that.
She called healthcare a privilege.
She called healthcare a privilege. I'm so sorry. I was reading the wrong quote.
Yes.
The quote where she, her clarification was that she's privileged to have healthcare, and I do believe it should be a right. I hope and pray moving forward that healthcare is a right for all worldwide.
Yeah,
I mean,
yeah.
But it's as vapid and as empty as the, you know, what is the most important issue to you? World peace, right? I mean, that's if you've seen Miss Congeniality.
That's the joke.
That was the joke. They all said world peace.
Yes.
Because that was a non-answer.
So one of my favorite beauty pageant quotes is when I was in high school, they had the Miss Colton pageant. I went to Colton High School, and several of the girls that were my classmates were competing. And one of them, when they got up there, they were just doing a little banter before the official question, and she worked at a place called Happy Steak, right? That was the restaurant. I used to work there, too, when I was in high school. And they asked this young lady, they said, so what exactly makes a happy steak? And she got this kind of bizarre look on her face and kind of shrugged her shoulders and says, I don't know, a happy cow? And it was hilarious. It was a great moment. And a perfectly delivered line, and it was funny, and it stuck with me all these years later. Dina Bowden was the girl who said it.
Oh my gosh, you're never going to let her live that down.
No, I adore her for saying it because it was the funniest, coolest thing I think I've ever seen.
A dumb question, let's be honest.
Yeah.
Well, you know, it's like, how do you feel about euthanasia? They're fine. You know, I mean, look, people, it's a beauty pageant for crying out loud.
But here's the thing, you know, this serious issue about healthcare, I mean, you and I have had this debate. I don't believe that healthcare is a right. You know, I'm not. I say I don't believe. I have questions about the idea of once you say it's a right, what does that mean to us as a society in terms of the policy and economic implications of that? You know, and what is it? How do you define healthcare as a right? Is it just access to healthcare? Is it that the government has to pay for 100% of everything that ever happens to you? You know, and so there's a lot of important specificity that you have to get into in a very complex issue, and I don't know that that's appropriate in the format of a beauty pageant.
Exactly. Well, and I have to say that, again, the thought police is a little out of control. We were talking to somebody who has a city-level office, and I'm not going to say what it is. I'm not going to say what city it is. And she was asked during her campaign how she felt about abortion. And she's like, really?
Yes.
Because, you know, a municipality gets to vote on that sort of thing? What a dumb question. No, but we need to know. Why do you need to know that?
Yes.
It has nothing to do with anything that this person would be doing while in their office.
Yes. But what's interesting, though, about that is it really says more about the voter that she was speaking to than it does about her as a candidate. And what you're finding out from that voter is that that's the one issue that matters for them. And they make judgments about who you are as a person and whether they can trust you or whether they would respect you or have confidence in you as a leader based on how you answer that question. Right.
It's just insane. That is fascistic.
It is.
You have to agree with me on this issue or any other number of issues that I think are important. And if you don't, then you're worthless and I'm going to boycott your business. And come on, people.
Yeah.
What the heck?
It's fascinating to me that people think and behave that way. I tell you, when I was in politics, it was quite disturbing sometimes. You'd knock on the door of a house and have a conversation with someone, and I would want to sort of introduce myself as a person and explain the issues that I was running on, and they would come out with me with something entirely different that had no bearing on my race, on the campaign I was running, but, you know, was important to them. And most often, the two issues that I ran into the most often was party affiliation, where the only thing they cared about was whether I was Republican or Democrat.
And you're like, this is a nonpartisan office.
Yeah, and they don't say that well on the ballot whether you're Republican or Democrat, you know. And I could tell them whatever I thought they wanted to hear, and they wouldn't have a way of knowing, you know. But these people, they were adamant. They had to know, you know, what party I was. And if I gave the wrong answer, I actually had a couple people who slammed doors in my face. And then the other issue, and this sadly, was race. I had people who, and I'll say Hispanic families, that in Colton, when I was campaigning for the Colton School Board, that basically told me I should be campaigning up in Grand Terrace because I was white. And didn't want to talk to me. And then I had folks that were in the Grand Terrace Cooley Ranch area who praised me, and, oh, my God, I'm so glad a white person is running. And in both instances, I felt horribly uncomfortable, And how do you respond to that?
Yeah,
because
how do
that's
you...
not what my campaign was about.
Right.
I wasn't running as the white candidate.
You want to look at them and say, really? That's the depth of your concern about the well-being of our schools or our city or our county or whatever?
Yeah.
Come on.
But it goes back to this woman who's at this pageant, you know? You ask, why did she get involved in this pageant? What's her goal? She wants to get some scholarship money. She wants to get, you know,
bragging rights, whatever.
You know, and then they ask this question, right? And, of course, this is televised, and now she's going to be – now, she won. You know, this woman won the competition. So, you know, she's got that to say.
She's on to Miss Universe or whatever. Yeah.
But, you know, people want to harangue her. They want to make fun of her. They want to lampoon her. Because they disagree with her answer.
Exactly. And she's a beauty pageant contestant.
And she works for, let me go back to this, because I said it in here, she's like a scientist or something for some major organization.
So the U.S. Nuclear Regulatory Commission.
Yes.
Yeah, so she's no dummy.
Right?
So ask her about nuclear power.
Thank you.
That's a novel idea.
What's the right way to say it? Is it nuclear? Nuclear?
Nuclear?
Nuclear? Nuclear? How do you say that word?
It's nuclear. Unless you're George W. Bush, and then it's nuclear.
That's the question you really want. How do you say that word?
No. How do you feel about Homer Simpson? Should he have been sleeping at his post?
Do you think he's eating too many donuts while at work?
Is your boss anything like Monty Burns?
Right. Right? That's what we all want
to know.
Those
are important, you know, questions that we all have to know the answers to.
Oh, my goodness.
So,
my goodness.
You know, lighten up, folks. Please, lighten up. It, you know, sometimes things aren't that serious.
Yes.
And she's a beauty pageant contestant. Lighten up.
Yes. And we can disagree about things, and the world's okay.
Exactly. Go sit down with somebody with whom you disagree, enjoy a beer together, or two beers, you can each have your own, and have a conversation that doesn't deal with whatever it is you disagree on.
Yeah.
People are people. Lighten up. With that happy news note, I'm going to try to say that at the same time. We're at the end of our show for today. Have a great weekend, everybody. I'm Aaron Brinker.
And I'm Tobin Brinker.
And we are on The Brink, the morning show on KCAA.
KCAA Loma Linda, 1050 AM, 106.5 FM, and now 102.3 FM.
I'm Chuck Kamlick, CNBC. Wall Street tries for two wins in a row. Stock futures are higher right now. Sales and profits are still